Good afternoon, or good day, or greetings appropriate for the time of the day for wherever you are logged in. Welcome to another masterclass, which is organized as part of our project in Kharana, which examines the proposal of introduction of blockchain technology in Indian elections. This election tech project at Kharana was initiated to focus on how technology could work for people and society. And we intend to undertake public deliberations and studies and produce reports that will help stimulate a lively discussion around the topic of introduction of blockchains and any other subsequent technology. We believe that this change, which is a significantly large one since the introduction of the EVM VVPAT system, should not have uncritical acceptance. This project is hosted at Kharana. Kharana is a collection of independent critiques of various aspects of digital India. My name is Shankarshan. I'm a member of the Kharana Collective, and I'm also the curator and promoter of this project. The project is supported by hasgig.com, a platform which has for over a decade now provided collaborations across practices surrounding technology, design, law, policy systems, data, among others. Hasgig believes that collaborations take place via user-generated content shared with practitioners, leading to discovery and elevation of ideas and individuals. Our master classes are created and designed to enable participants to acquire foundational knowledge and perspectives required to evaluate the intended and unintended consequences of technology interventions. Before I go on to introducing our speaker, and I must say that I'm very excited about today's class, because primarily I'm excited about the fact that our speaker has finally found time to participate in this. A few housekeeping notes. One, this masterclass is also being streamed on YouTube, so we will be keeping an eye on the chat box at YouTube for questions and clarifications, and then pass them on to Zoom over here to be discussed and answered. Usually we prefer that all questions and discussions get lined up for the end and get queued using the raise hand systems in Zoom. The raise hand, the raising of hand in a Zoom software application is generally available under the reactions menu item. Depending on the operating system you are using and the Zoom build, it may be somewhere else, so you have to figure that one out. And if you cannot and you still want to have that question and conversation up, please put that in the Zoom chat and we'll take it from there. If you are not speaking, we would like you to keep your mic on mute so that the sound quality of this recording is better. The last thing is that if you do want to have a particular point during the presentation clarified, please put it on Zoom chat. We will bring it up so that the speaker can provide clarification on that particular point. And this is something that we have been anticipating will happen, especially in today's talk. So let's use that judiciously and figure out as to how best we can have the conversations. Now, to introduce our speaker, Tarangini Sriraman. Tarangini teaches politics and history at the School of Liberal Studies in Assumption Franklin University at Bangalore. Her recently published book, In Pursuit of Proof, A History of Identification Documents in India, weaves together the hitherto unattempted history of making and verifying identification documents in the urban margins of India. She's been a prolific and regular contributor of articles and has written for various popular publications such as The Hindu, The News Minute, The New Indian Express, The Friend, The Wire. She's also featured in journals such as The Economic and Political Weekly, contributions to the Indian Sociology, Indian Economic and Social History Review, and so on. She's currently working on something that's exceedingly exciting. It's a new project that looks at how caste structures and medical discourses on alcohol and our various dissenting publics are formed around alcohol regulation in colonial and post-colonial India. Before I hand it over to Tarangini for her masterclass and discussion, I'd just like to put this in context that any conversation around elections in India eventually touch upon the topic of electoral rolls, and in slowly and surely we touch upon the topic of uniquely identifying Indian citizens and how it affects various outcomes in an election. The fun part is, and I deliberately choose the word fun, is that this search for uniqueness is not something that has happened recently. The search for uniqueness has been happening for a while, and Tarangini has been working on this topic and is an expert for us to be able to provide that window into realizing that the search continues, and there are consequences of how various approaches have created over the period of time. So with that, I'll stop my spiel and hand it over to our speaker, Tarangini, all yours.
Thanks, Sankarshan. In fact, I'd like to start by thanking Sankarshan, Zainab, and HasGeek for this very generous invitation to partake of the masterclass series, which is an excellent series. And I have been watching some of the other masterclasses. And what I'm going to be saying today is mostly just going to complement what has already been said. And of course, I hope to be able to also make a few distinctive arguments in the process. But yeah, I'm looking forward to this. Okay. Let me start by actually sharing my screen. Just a sec. You're able to see, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, okay, great. Okay, so I have changed the title of the presentation a little bit. I hope the listeners, the audience here does not mind. So it's right now how I have titled and framed the presentation for today, the masterclass for today is around constructing uniqueness before and after Aadhaar, right? And the subtitle being Histories of Authentication in India. Okay, let's start by actually defining the term authentication and seeing what it means, right? So the Cambridge English Dictionary provides a certain definition of the term authentication, where it says authentication is a process of proving that something or someone is real, true, or what people say it is or who they are, right? So, you know, by this token, by this definition, a lot of things are covered under the term, come under the term authentication, right? So it could be authentication by password, as for instance, authentication that your laptop, for instance, may require for you to be able to access it, right? Which you have set up, right? Or it could be biometric authentication, as for instance, when you want to ensure that your phone is not easily hackable, right? So you set up a biometric authentication to open and to lock your phone, right? You can also use the term authentication in other contexts, right? Like for instance, there's barcode authentication, there's authentication using RFID tags, right? And so you have a whole range of modes or modalities of authenticating, right? So what we are, however, going to be touching on is the most and the more contemporary and the more topical and the more, now the of having to do with the here and the now modality of authentication or discussion of authentication, right? Which has to do with a certain type of authentication that Aadhaar goes by. And here, if you to look at Aadhaar, and I'm not going to go into a vast elaborate introduction of Aadhaar, I will be saying a few things along the way about it later on also. But let's start by talking about how Aadhaar, being a cloud-based biometric authentication process, is something that relies on, for instance, the authentication of person as well as the authentication of process, right? So Aadhaar authentication has both these implications. So if you were to talk about authentication of a person via the UIDAI, the Unique Identification Authority of India, again, there are multiple ways of going about it, right? So there is the verification of demographic details with something called the Central Identities Data Repository, which is the Aadhaar database, so to speak, right? And then there is the OTP-based authentication, right? Sometimes when, for instance, you want to change your address or when you're carrying out some other function, like for instance, you're trying to file a tax return using your Aadhaar, there is OTP-based authentication that also happens, right? Which has limited viability. and which is to be used then and there. And then there is multi-factor authentication as well, which implies or which means that so the UIDAI recognizes the fingerprint, the iris, as well as the photograph as three different types of biometrics that it can use to authenticate a person, right? So the so while there are all these modalities of authentication, even as far as Aadhaar is concerned, we must remember that, of course, the UIDAI prioritizes certain kinds of authentication over others. Like multi-factor authentication, OTP authentication are seen to be much more reliable than, say, the verification of demographic details alone, right? So this is something to be kept in mind. And of course, Aadhaar is something that also entails a unique number identifier, right? So the number is also something that is supposed to be there in the cloud. And cloud-based authentication is also a concept that we should be wrapping our heads around, right? And which, of course, is not removed from all the other things that I've been speaking about. Then there is the authentication of process itself. So it's not just enough to authenticate a person. The process through which you are doing this, you're carrying this out, is also to be legitimate, right? So someone other than a data operator registered by the UIDAI is not qualified really to carry out authentication of person. And that's something to be kept in mind. Apologies for the background noise. So I just wanted to clarify here that, for instance, there are certain enrollment centers which are authorized and which feature, for instance, certain data operators who alone have the authority to carry out authentication, Aadhaar-based authentication, right? So now let's take a look at the ways in which this may have gone awry, right? So the sites of Aadhaar authentication, do they really hold up, right? So whether you're talking about authentication of person or you're talking about authentication of process, right? So if you were to look at the picture to your right, the image to your right, this is an Aadhaar that was issued to the deity Hanuman, right? So if authentication is supposed to imply imply that you are making sure that a person is who they say it is, right, then this does not really hold up, right? This kind of authentication does not hold up because you have an Aadhaar that is being issued to a deity instead of a person, right? And there are other examples also of which I will give you of authentication of person which have gone awry. But apart from this, if you were to look at authentication of process, there too there have been multiple issues, right? So if it is only authorized operators who are supposed to be able to access the database and issue an Aadhaar, that is also not really held up in certain cases. Like for instance, Gurgaon especially has seen a whole bunch of quote unquote fake Aadhaar centers, right? Where it has been commonplace to get the rubber stamps of the thumbprints or the fingerprints of these authorized operators, and then access the database without authorization, right? And so in that sense, it is regarded as a fake Aadhaar center. Now, you also have other sites also, for instance, of how deduplication has not really happened, right? Like for instance, if you to look at the controller and auditor general who came up with this report in 2016, and the CAG's office has come up with this report which documents how the process of seeding the Aadhaar with the provision of gas cylinders is again a process that has been mismanaged, right? And so if you were to look at the underlying parts, right? So there have been very many duplicate connections. There have been connections bearing the same name, same address, right? And the audit also verified existence of connections with same name, same date of birth and same registered mobile number, same Aadhaar number, same bank IFSC, same bank account number. So there is absolutely no guarantee that seeding with Aadhaar is going to remove duplicates, right? In that sense. Okay, so I wanted us to wrap our heads around this whole concept of what Aadhaar authentication is before we move forward, because I want to trace my steps backwards, right, and take us as far back as possible within colonial India, right? And I want to also talk about how Aadhaar authentication is of course a part of this whole discourse where there is a certain claim of uniqueness that is being made. There's a certain claim of unique identities being created, right? And there's a certain claim of cutting edge technology behind it, and how this is like a vast leap forward in terms of where we are at within the history of something like authentication, though that same term may not have been used earlier on. Now, while assessing this claim, we need to also be able to discern or identify whether such similar arguments have been made in the past, right? And whether these kinds of claims of innovativeness have also been made in the past, right? Apologies. But while assessing these claims, we also should be keeping in mind certain other things, right? Whether or not this claim has been made that certain technologies are way more advanced and are able to produce certain effects of infallibility, of truthfulness, of reliability, of scalability, all of which have been made, for instance, in the case of Aadhaar, right? When we're assessing these claims, we need to also keep in mind certain other things. And these are the things that I want to showcase through this masterclass, right? And these I'm presenting in the form of arguments. So uniqueness, of course, goes by different names in the 19th and 20th centuries, and we're going to be looking at that. But the other thing that I'm also going to be talking about is that all technologies prior to Aadhaar and as far back as mid-19th century are all making a claim to universality and scientificity, right? They're saying that not all of them, but certain technologies are doing it more than others. Let's put it that way, right? So fingerprinting is making that claim much more than, say, photography is, right? And they're all making this claim to some form of scientificity, some semblance of reliability, right? Much more than what came before, right? But even as they are making these universalistic claims, all these technologies are tied to surveillance of marginalized groups. And this, what might appear to be a paradox, but may not necessarily be one, this particular conjunction of things is something we need to closely dwell on, right? That certain technologies are making a universalistic claim and that they are also tied to surveillance of marginalized groups is something that we need to closely examine. Before I move to the next argument, I also wanted to mention this. I'm also going to be relying on arguments made by other scholars, right? This one scholar called Karen Weitzberg, who is also saying that a certain technology may have also started off as somewhat narrowed, right? Narrow in terms of who it is targeted at. Then it may have become much more universal. But even after becoming universal, it retains certain biases, right? Towards marginal groups and towards marginalized groups. That's again something to be kept in mind. Then we need to also talk about how, whether it is pitched as universal or whether it is pitched as something more narrow, right? All these technologies have ended up raising the stakes for these groups, right? Have raising the stakes for marginalized groups. And associated with this, remember that whether we're talking about fingerprinting, anthropometry, photography, right, or other security measures, innovations that have been brought in, which I'm going to be laying out for you, right, the metrics, right, and the yardsticks of uniqueness, of what is unique, right, using this technology are different for different people, right? That's again something that we're going to be looking at. Then we're going to be also talking about how post-2010, you also have authentication that spawns techno-utopias, right? So these sister, I'm going to call them sister and cousin concerns, right? Such as purification and purity. And that's again something that we'll be looking at. I'm going to come up with certain examples. Start by looking as far back as the mid to late 19th century, right? And here I want to be, I want to talk about the various other terms, of course, that fingerprint, various other terms that uniqueness, for instance, is uniqueness and authentication go by. But before we do that, I just wanted to flag your attention to one thing, which is that if you were to look at the history of fingerprinting, especially, whether it is a Kenyan historian, whether it is a South African historian, a British historian, or an Indian historian who is writing about this, one thing that is common across all of this is that fingerprinting has, the history of fingerprinting has strong affinities to what was happening both in England and in India, right? And so of course, these histories are like global in the sense that there's something that connects fingerprinting and its story across these various centers, the ones that I mentioned. But there are a few developments that happen in England and India that are particularly important to take note of, right? And we'll start from there. So if you look at the roots of fingerprinting, one of the cases that rivets the attention of several of the pioneers, right, or the several of the pioneering figures, whether we're talking about Henry Foulds, who is a Scottish physician, William Herschel, who is a British civil servant, as well as a magistrate at some point, serving at some point in Bengal, or whether we're talking about Edward Henry, a police official, right, or we are talking about Francis Galton, right, who is a scientist and also the cousin of Charles Darwin. Like all these pioneering figures of fingerprinting, right, are all riveted with one case that happens. And here I am relying on the scholarship of Edward Higgs, the historian, the British historian, who tells us that all these pioneers in some way or the other, explicitly or implicitly, cite the case of what happened with Sir Roger Tichborne, right? Now, Roger Tichborne, a knighted personality, so he leaves on a journey, and he's supposed to have gotten shipwrecked, right? Essentially, he takes off on a journey, and then his ship kind of like drops off somewhere, and he goes missing. And in the aftermath of this incident, someone who is later pronounced to be a butcher, right, comes forward and claims to be the one and only Sir Roger Tichborne, right? Now, caught up with this case is a story of what is believed to be theft of private property, impersonation, right? Because the court trial that unfolded in the 1870s, and it's a long court trial, a colorful, spectacular one, the identity of this person, of course, is in question. There are mobilizations on all sides, right? But what these pioneers of fingerprinting are pointing out is that had there been a certain established, well-established system of fingerprinting, then this would not have happened. So remember, the paranoia at this point in time is one of ensuring protection of private property and also of fortifying British capitalist society against these kinds of petty thefts and impersonations by the riffraff, right, so to speak, right? Because if a butcher can dream of it, then what next? So the other thing that I wanted to mention is that while, of course, there are these kinds of narrow fears and anxieties, there's also a universalistic claim that is being made by many of these figures. So let me just move forward and I'll come back to the slide. So Henry Foulds, for instance, talks about how, like when he writes, and he's one of the first men to write, the Scottish physician is one of the first men to write about fingerprinting. He comes up with this book called The Guide to Fingerprint Identification, where among other things, he's talking about how if you to look at our fingerprints and you will see, if you to look at our fingertips, right? What you will notice is that it is made up of ridges and furrows, right? And he says that it resembles a plowed field. I think more helpfully also, if you were to apply some ink or if you were to dip your finger in ink and then look at it, examine it properly, that you will see ridges and furrows. Now, the ridges are the upraised parts, the elevated parts, while the furrows are the white depressed parts. Now, the furrows, of course, are can form into different patterns, right? So then he is also interested in looking at what those patterns look like. Like, for instance, if you look at this image, he's looking at how, you know, the furrows, for instance, would resemble voles, arches, loops, right, hooks, junctions. And he's also interested in looking at various patterns. Like, for instance, among the arches, you have different types, right? And again, among the voles, you have different types. He's interested then in, like, classifying these patterns as well. So, so of course, he is also invested in establishing the scientificity of fingerprinting and its truthfulness over time, right? Now, William Herschel has interesting ways of doing this. Like, for instance, what he does is he collects the fingerprints of the many of the functionaries who pass through Bengal while he's serving there as a magistrate in one of the districts. And what he does is he takes these fingerprints of these functionaries, right, whoever they may be, magistrates, collectors, etc. And then he asks them, requests them to send him their fingerprints after 30 years. He does the same for his own son. And what he notices then is a permanence of patterns, persistency of prints. And these are, again, terms that one can associate, right, early on. Like, for instance, these are the terms that also, I mean, they may not be synonymous exactly with uniqueness, but uniqueness is something that is, uniqueness is a claim that is made out of these kinds of assertions, right? William Herschel is also interested simultaneously in using fingerprinting as a technology to determine pension fraud and to hold riots or peasants to indentured contracts such that they cannot flee and abscond and you know, abdicate their responsibilities towards the zamindar. So these are all things to keep in mind. Of course, both Foltz and Herschel also recommend fingerprinting for convicts and criminal tribes. Now, what are the implications of this? The implications of recommending fingerprinting for convicts and criminal tribes, and if you especially consider criminal tribes, is that now in the late 19th century, when you have criminal tribes who are being held responsible for various crimes, right? The laws were also such that if a certain crime had happened in the vicinity and there was someone who belonging from a criminal tribe, then the law pretty much stated that you would have to hold that person guilty, right? And so fingerprinting then did not have so much forensic value in terms of, like, you know, inquiring into the facticity, into the truthfulness of whether that person had really committed the crime, but rather it was sometimes used to justify these arrests, right? So that's again something to keep in mind. Okay, just give me a second, just drink some water. Okay, so now we move on to the history of photography, right? So here both Radhika Singha and Claire Anderson write that that photography was much more accurate than descriptive rules. Now, before I move forward, I want to also mention that, of course, when compared to something like fingerprinting, photography was seen to be much less reliable, right? Like, especially if you had, a large collection of photographic prints, then using that collection to narrow down who your suspects were, it was going to be somewhat difficult to manage, right? And especially if you're looking for one guilty person, right, whom you have a certain, graphic visual image of, right? So, but at the same time, while of course photography was seen to be less reliable than fingerprinting in that sense, and you didn't have those many yes men who were, pushing the case of photography forward in terms of its infallibility and uniqueness, etc., it is still to be kept in mind that photography was, however, upheld as being very useful as a supplemental device, right? Now, what do I mean by that? So if you were to look at the scholarship of historians like Radhika Singh and Claire Anderson, they are writing about descriptive roles being used, for instance, to identify convicts who are being sent to Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And in this regard, if you were to look at what these descriptive roles contained, then they had visual descriptions. Like when I say visual, I mean to say they had like descriptions, not in terms of photographs. They had descriptions of like, you know, what a person's complexion was, all written, right? Textual description of what a person's what a person's complexion was. Textual description also of, you know, the size of a person's earlobe, or the size of a person's forehead, or distinguishing marks, tattoos maybe, moles maybe, right? So it was believed, Radhika Singha, for instance, writes about how photography was seen to be a useful supplement to this. If the descriptive role were to have this kind of textual description and the photograph, then that would make it much more useful in terms of identifying the convict, right? But the other thing to also keep in mind is that photography was also being used to draw profiles of certain persons, certain people, sorry, not persons, but people or groups, right? So more than its forensic use, right, in terms of being able to tell who a convict was, or in terms of being able to tell who a criminal was, it was used much more to capture certain profiles of people together. Right, so dying races, right, thugs maybe, right. When they were photographed collectively, it also conveyed a certain scientific picture of objective picture of what they looked like socioculturally, right. So you have to also remember that photography was caught up with this kind of agenda. Now, as far as various administrators were concerned, they, of course, believed, and here again, Radhika Singha is telling us that they believed that photography was useful, especially when you had like photographs, photographic prints being circulated through post, right? And so where, for instance, police stations received certain prints and then put it up, it was convenient for them, a ready reckoner for them, right, in terms of being able to identify criminals, right? So of course, it's less universal than fingerprinting, however useful for capturing collective traits, but also useful in the sense that it was a good supplemental device and was definitely an improvement over a mere textual description of, say, a criminal. But here again, let's remember that photography was also caught up with profiling certain groups. Okay, so yeah, I think I've kind of more or less talked about all this, so I'm going to move on. So all of this, of course, throws up all kinds of resonances with the histories of biometrics in other parts of the world, right? Like, especially if you were to take Kenya and South Africa, and I'm going to want to briefly touch on that as well. So to start with, let's look at what a scholar like Karen Weitzberg is telling us, right? So she writes and tells us about the narrow origins of what is called the Kipande, or the moving pass system in Kenya, right? Now, the Kipande, or the moving pass, is supposed to be a comprehensive comprehensive history of the mobility, of the transactions, of the employment of the black laboring person, right, in Kenya, right? And so this is very much a feature of white settler capitalism, right, and colonial history of Kenya, right? So we need to be looking at how the Kipande system was caught up with black surveillance of labor within a capitalist colonial system, right? So what Weitzberg, however, tells us is that even after universalization of fingerprinting, the ID system is something that retains its biases, right? And it retains its biases in the sense that even though white persons were also supposed to be fingerprinted at a certain point in time, there's a way in which its mandate for surveilling and for profiling Black people as such, not just Black labor, but Black people as such, remains, is what she talks about. Now, if one were to like move much forward, and here, you know, both Nanjala Nyabola, who spoke in one of the previous masterclasses, as well as Abidi Lataf Lahri, both of them also write extensively on the more contemporary ID, digital ID system of Kenya, which goes by Huduma number, or which just translates into service number in Swahili, right? And so there, if you were to look at the digital ID system, here it's supposed to be universal. It is the government is also run by Black people, right, of Kenya, right? And yet, even here, you see that it retains several discriminatory potentials, and it retains all kinds of profiling impulses, right? Now, what do I mean by this? So Kenyans of Nubian descent, meaning people from Sudan who were brought over into Kenya as soldiers by the British, right? So Kenyans of Nubian descent, Somalis, Maasais, all experience the Huduma number differently, right? So so again, what is being written here and said here is that, look, it is a universal biometric ID, but the metrics and the yardsticks of what uniqueness implies are going to be interpreted differently, right? And what we mean by this here, what we mean by this is that, you know, there are vetting committees, for instance, that look into the eligibility of some of these groups, and the bar is quite unsurprisingly, ridiculously, absurdly high, right, for some of these groups and some of these people. Right? So, you know, in terms of what time of the day they're supposed to be present, in terms of what times of the season that they're supposed to come and present their application form, in terms of like the land deeds that they're present, in terms of their ability to prove a paternal descent, all of this, the metrics are much more harsh when it comes to some of these groups, right? And so you're kind of not just raising the bar and stakes for select groups, but you're also coming up with shifting goalposts, which I think I won't speak about for this particular case, but let me actually talk about that moving forward, right? So this is again something for us to keep in mind. But having said this, I also want us to take note of one heartening feature in all this, which is that you have had organized dissent against these pass systems, whether you're talking about the apartheid pass system, which goes by the name of Dumpus, right, in South Africa in the 50s and the 60s, or whether you're talking about more contemporary organized dissent against dissent, or also organized forms of collaboration to ensure that Nubians, for instance, people of Nubian descent do not get left behind, right? So there's been a lot of instances of that as well. So the image to your left is sourced from the Facebook page of the Nubian Rights Forum. And this gives you an illustration, or this image gives you an illustration of how the Nubian Rights Forum has been mobilizing around very many important things, like including if a person has been rejected by a vetting committee, then the Nubian Rights Forum finds a way of putting that person in touch with others who've also been rejected, and then having a conversation happen within them, right, such that they can mobilize better, and such that they can anticipate what the vetting committee will say the next time they appear. And the image to your right is from the march by South African women, right, against the apartheid pass system in the 50s and the 60s, right? Okay. So now I'm going to come back to India. And why am I segueing from a discussion of the history of fingerprinting in Kenya and South Africa to a discussion of ration cards? So what I want to say is that just as I discussed in the case of Kenya and South Africa, where you have different metrics and yardsticks that are being used for the same thing, for the same claim of uniqueness, right? Here too, in India too, that has happened, right? Now, if you were to look at the history of ration cards, right? And rationing identification practices, then what you see is that during the 1940s, especially during the World War, you have the ration card that comes in a big way. So of course, there are several prototypes of the ration card. There's a family ration card, there's an individual ration card and other documents, right? The ration card for the heavy manual laborer, the application form for extra rations for the pregnant woman, so on and so forth. But the family ration card sort of materializes and it kind of gets consolidated, right, as the standard by the early 1950s, right? But even before that, if you were to look at some of the conversations that happened around how to fortify and how to strengthen the ration card, right? So there were conversations that happened during the World War around how to bring a lot of security measures, right? And these security measures were proposed especially by the governor of Bombay, someone called A.D. Gorwala, in the 1940s. And he proposes certain security measures, which are then you know, popularized across the colony, right, by different provinces and states. And he proposes that there should be color backgrounds that the ID should have, right, which are distinctive, which stand out. And there should be certain kinds of printing paper that is used, right, or certain number denominations, indents to the ration card, the serial numbers, right. Serial numbers again, which correspond, right? Like whether you're talking about the serial number of this, the register that is kept in the circle office and the serial number of the ration card itself, they should correspond, right? And counterfoils, right? Of application forms where officials can retain the counterfoil and then give another to the applicant, right? So also remember that it is only when these security measures keep changing that the document also is supposed to be stronger, supposed to become stronger. So one way to make vulnerable documents, and quote unquote vulnerable documents, because this is colonial jargon, right? So one way to make vulnerable documents less vulnerable is to also keep changing the security measures that you're using, right? But what we also need to remember is that, as I was telling you, the family ration card pretty much becomes standardized and emerges as what is termed a factum of residence, right, by the 1950s. And this is something that we notice, for instance, with the Delhi ration card. Since I did my field work in Delhi, I can speak much more confidently about this particular region. So if you were to look at the period around which time the standardization happens, and the standardization happens mainly by this triangulation that emerges between the ration card holder and then the circle office, but also the person who's called the authorized retail distributor, who later becomes the fair price shop dealer, right? So this triangulation was very important, right? And the various details in the ration card were supposed to be maintained by all three persons, right? And the serial number was a particularly important a feature that connected all these three sites, all these three points, right? Now, of course, while all this innovation was happening, right, in a big way, what we need to remember is that around the same time, you also had the partition that occurred. And post-partition, you had you of course had all kinds of attempts by refugees to claim housing, right? And in this regard, we should keep in mind that the ration card played a significant role, right? And because refugees were being told that they should leave behind their ration card in Pakistan and then apply for a new ration card when they came to India. And in this regard, you had Punjabi, Sikh, and Hindu refugees. And I look mainly at these refugees. Of course, there are Bengali, Kashmiri refugees, but I don't look at that. I don't look at them in my book, and because my, as I said, my region has been Delhi. So using those case studies, what I can tell you is that while, of course, several refugees experienced all manner of difficulties in terms of using ration cards, applying for ration cards, presenting them, Dalit refugees and women refugees experienced ration cards differently. And what I mean by this is that when a Dalit refugee, for instance, was given a ration card, and when a Dalit refugee possessed a ration card for her or his family as a whole, right? What happened is that when they went and presented this ration card, say in a place like Rohtak or in Delhi, they were often told by the person giving them the rations that, look, as a Dalit, you should not really be asking for sugar rations. So they were denied sugar rations, even though their ration card was supposed to be giving them the same entitlements as others, right? And there are other stories as well. So women refugees, for instance, again, experienced ration cards differently, because remember that at this point in time, a woman was neither supposed to be a de facto refugee, nor was a woman really supposed to have a ration card issued in her name. And when it happened, there was a lot of suspicion about why it had happened. So women refugees who were submitting application forms, right, for housing compensation, when they attached ration cards as part of their application, they were often viewed with suspicion by rehabilitation, housing and rehabilitation authorities, who were like, okay, her ration card probably looked pretty much the same as any other ration card did. And she was also able to show that she had been like, she'd been claiming rations regularly. However, the cloud of suspicion was over the fact that that the ration card was not issued in her husband's name. Also, where was her husband through all this? Was he going in and out? In that case, should we really be recognizing her claim alone for the purposes of giving her housing compensation? Right. So these are again examples I wanted to give. Now I want to move, of course, it's a huge leap forward, but I still thought that I would make that leap. Because if you were to look at the move towards digital documentation, I mean, maybe the term documentation is not as ideal as perhaps digital authentication, right? Here, of course, the UIDAI and the Aadhaar emerge as novel centerpieces of an electronic era. And the move towards it is dictated by many things. There is a certain specter of fraud, of duplicates, and of a certain staleness of what is regarded as a staleness of the ID ecosystem, right? Because it's stale because people are stuck where they are, right? People are not able to enjoy a certain free mobility, right? And often the figure of the migrant worker is very readily cited to support this claim of suppressed mobility, right? And in all these senses, there is a urgent case that is being made. And of course, the mascot of that is Nandan Nilekani, who makes a certain claim that in order for there to be a foolproof and unassailable identity authentication mechanism, we need something that cannot be tied down to a piece of paper. We need something that is out there in the cloud, and something that can be accessed without mediation that is suspicious, right? Without intermediaries and all kinds of suspect mediation, right? And what he also calls intermediation, right? So there's also a certain necessity that he carves out. He makes a special case also for the need for centralized databases. Though, of course, the UIDAI as such has been entirely comfortable with the edifice of both state and privatized information gathering, right? So the virtues of the new identity authentication mechanisms are, of course, number portability, deduplication, a certain directness of transaction, Right? These are some of the virtues, and of course, scalability, right? More than anything else, scalability. Scalability in terms of like accessing goods, services, commodities, right? In terms of what insurance companies, banks, government departments, among others, can accomplish, right? And of course, it is set up by design to enable convergence, right? And though maybe they will never admit it, also the cross-working of databases, right? Okay, now, this is something that we know, so I'm not spending much time on it. What I am, however, going to be talking about is, you know, the kind of sister and cousin concerns that Aadhaar authentication has spawned, right? And we can talk about a certain cascading effect that authentication has had with Aadhaar rollout, right? And it has definitely played a role in incubating techno-utopic agendas. And we can talk about purification as being a sister concern of authentication. Now, we know what authentication implies. What does purification imply? Now, in order to talk about this, we need to also look at what was happening around the time of 2015, when the Election Commission was interested in embarking on this ambitious exercise of using its own database and comparing it with the UIDAI database and weeding out not just duplicates, but people whose names don't match in both these databases, across these databases, right? And that is what purification was, right? It was about cleaning the existing database, that is the database that was with the Election Commission. And it was about removing the names of people who do not exist in both these databases. So how to go about doing this, right? And how is it that the Election Commission went forward, right? And remember that this exercise went on for a while until the Supreme Court put an end to it, right? In the case of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, the project had picked up a lot of pace, right? And one day, the people of Telangana woke up to see, many of them woke up to see that their names were missing. So around somewhere between 25 and 30 lakh voters' names were reported to have been missing in Telangana. Of course, the state electoral officer of Telangana claimed that this may have been because of bifurcation of the states, but there was no corresponding rise in the voters' names in Andhra Pradesh, right? So the, of course, that claim was a very suspect one. Now, what we need to keep in mind is that by this time, it is argued that this electoral roll purification could have happened, and that a certain exercise of cross comparing or cross matching electoral rolls with the UIDAI database may have happened by this time. So, and here, and we're talking about 2018, which is the time that the 30 lakh voters' names have gone missing, right? So between 2015 and 2018, this may have happened, right? And what we also notice is that if you look at exactly how this process of purification unfolded, then there were, if I'm not mistaken, there were three categories. There was a name, there was a date of birth, and then there was date of birth, and also the PIN code, right? So these three categories across both databases were compared, and then a score was assigned, right, based on the match, right, of these categories across both the databases. A score was assigned to each voter, right? And of course, if the score was high, then the voter was in. If the score was low, then the voter may have been out, right? So of course, none of this is possible to state vehemently as having absolutely happened, because we have a lot of denials that that happen, whether we're talking about the Election Commission or other authorities, right? That's something to keep in mind. But this is not this is of course not all that happens, right? But before we get to the SRDH point, I want to also show you, like, for instance, this is what the algorithms the matching algorithms may have looked like. I am not in a position to comment on these algorithms and how they work. It looks like they were configured to work phonetically and to come up with phonetic matches. And then there's also spelling and of course long strings and short strings. and all of that. I'm not going to be able to comment on any of that. However, what I can comment on is this. Let us look at what the enabling conditions of authentication are, right? So if you to look at what the enabling conditions of authentication are, one, I mean, that is, when I say enabling conditions, I mean that authentication would not have been possible had it not been for certain things, right? Which is that you are taking for granted data sharing without consent, right? You're also okay with carrying out algorithmic decision-making or enabling algorithmic decision-making, because if you're pretty much leaving it to a set of algorithms to decide whether a voter should be in the electoral roll or not, right? And of course, there's a question of suppressing democracy. Here I want to read out to you a quote by Srinivas Kodali, who tweets about this. He's, and he tweets especially about the missing votes in Telangana. He says, democracy is not only about voting. I express it with every complaint I make and every judicial method I use. Today, I can't vote because I'm not in voter list. The entire preparation and deletions of voter list has become non-transparent. The election commission has conducted itself unethically. Now, I want to also talk about how, you know, just as he is writing about, it's democracy is not simply about voting, the right to vote, but it's also about having certain information based on which you can make a decision about how you want to vote, right? And unfortunately, that information also is wielded by, to a great extent, by authorities like the Election Commission, right? Okay, I also want to point your attention to something else which happened, around this time, which is that it is not just a question of voters' names that went missing. Apart from this, you also need to keep in mind the existence of something called the State Resident Data Hub, right? And the State Resident Data Hub, of course, has access to different data sets. And if you to look at it, the State Resident Data Hub is like this vast server, right, which has like all kinds of demographic details, but it also has, in particular, Aadhaar details, voter ID or EPIC details, and also it has other demographic details. Now this in itself is dangerous, and of course, outside what the UIDAI claimed was legitimate, right? Allowing for another database which also contains Aadhaar information is in itself supposed to be wrong, right? But this is something that is that has happened, right? And so it is also reported by there's a report especially in HuffPo about this, about how there could have been potential voter profiling by a party in Andhra Pradesh. Now, how did this happen? So a particular company developed this app called the Seva Mitra app, and the Seva Mitra app was also used to access the data sets in SRDH, and especially the data sets pertaining to the voter IDs, the EPICs, and this particular information, this particular information pertaining to voters' profiles fell into the hands of a party. Now, of course, the party in power and the party that is planning to go to election, that the line between this is very slim, right? The line between the party in power and the party that is planning to go to election is very slim, right? So again, you can think of the dangerous implications of something like this, right? Dangerous implications of having an SRDH which has these kinds of like demographic and biometric details, and how easily it can procure and access the SRDH to carry out all kinds of manipulations of voters' choices, right? That's again something to keep in mind. So in all these senses, what I am trying to argue is that authentication is spawning not just techno-utopias in the form of sister concerns like purification, but authentication is also enabling all kinds of political engineering, in this case, of voters' choices, right? Whether or not it has happened, and we're not going to really get into that, the fact that this is a possibility is still extremely dangerous. Now we move on to speaking about the National Register of Citizens. If I spoke of authentication as having a cascading effect and as having certain effects of, for instance, enabling purification, then something else that it has also enabled is certain ethno-nationalist projects. And in particular, it has also enabled certain kinds of political engineering around indigeneity or around the question of purity or pure indigeneity, right? And it is to be noted here, by the way, that the National Register of Citizens is a document-based register. Of course, I mean, document-based, when I say document-based, I mean that certain documents are seen to be extremely valuable in terms of like determining who belongs, who doesn't, right? So a document-based pure ethnic identity is something that is being determined, right? As against a biometric cloud-based identity. And that is one intrinsic important distinction to be making between the NRC and something like the Aadhaar. So what you have is a hybrid entity of a pure indigeneity or purity of ethnic belonging that has now emerged. Now, what I also want to be arguing at this point in time is that, of course, if you to look at the origins of the NRC, you can date it as far back as, say, the 1950s, right, with a register of citizens emerging in Assam, even back 1951. And of course, there have been several kinds of developments, right, whether it is the Assam Accord, whether it is the rise of certain regional parties, student parties and other parties in Assam. And you can talk about all kinds of other actors, like whether you're talking about the election commission or talking about the courts, right, all entering the fray and insisting on the need to remove quote unquote illegal immigrants, right, and to remove those who are also not indigenous to Assam. These assertions and demands have come from different quarters, and this is not the space to get into a long history of that. However, what I will say is that if you were to look at the actual implementation of the NRC, which takes off around 2013-2014, right? I would like to argue that had it not been for the massive rollout of Aadhaar, that a certain strong conviction in being able to pull off the NRC and scale it up would not have perhaps emerged, right? This kind of conviction would not have perhaps taken off had it not been for the massive rollout of the Aadhaar. That is something that I want to conjecture here. But apart from this, what I would also like to point out is that when I told you that I would also wanted to speak about shifting goalposts, this is something that I think is very true of the NRC project. So if you were to look at the application form for the NRC, and which is something that I was looking at closely yesterday, right? And if you were to look at the application form, you would notice that there is, of course, an emphasis on legacy data. And the legacy data can be many things. But there is constantly the sense that one gets that it's not enough to produce any one of the legacy data documents, right? In addition, you have to also provide documentation of, say, the electoral roll of before 1971, right? So, of course, electoral roll figures also as one of the possible legacy data documents. But if you're able to provide a certain documentation that you your name figured in the electoral rolls before 1971, that may be enough. But if you're providing something else, right, some other kind of legacy data, then you have to also provide electoral roll documentation, or at least that's what it looks like in the application form. I may have gotten it right, but I also wanted to present a certain picture of what an applicant may experience while witnessing the application form, right? And whether or not it holds up is a different thing. But the application form itself is also designed to overwhelm you. And we can talk about that also in the question round. I'm not going to talk about it much now. But when I was talking about shifting goalposts, I also meant that no matter what you produce, right, as documentation to show that you were definitely a person residing in Assam before the stipulated date in 1971, right, it's not going to be enough often, right, because there's a way in which a smudge, right, in your documents or a lack of correspondence, right, between your surname in one document and another, and the lack of, say, compatibility between your documents, the something or the other that is going to emerge to incriminate you, right? So there's always going to be a certain way in which the goalposts are going to shift for you when the authorities examine your application form. This has happened with the Foreigners Tribunal in Assam, and this is true even of the authorities that are signing off on whether you should be included in the NRC or not. The other thing to mention here is that the NRC has also induced all kinds of archival panics, right? So there's been a beeline to the West Bengal archives and other archives where people are looking for documentation that establishes their lineage in terms of their whether their grandparents may have been included in electoral lists, census documents, etc., right? And that's again, that's again an extremely unfortunate state of things, right? While of course it's wonderful that archives are seeing the footfall of people that they may not usually, the fact that some people are able to access these archival documents and that they're able to make reliable claims and others are not is also extremely worrying. Now, the last point I want to make as far as the NRC is concerned is that denials will always spawn more denials, but inclusion does not always guarantee more inclusion, right? So for instance, you also have something called the D status or the doubtful status in your voter ID, right? So based on various developments, the Election Commission was also tasked with the exercise of determining who was a legitimate voter and who was a doubtful voter. Now, if you were a doubtful voter, then the chances that you are going to be found to be not a legitimate resident of Assam are high, right? And the chances that you're going to be found guilty by a foreigners tribunal are high, right? But if, for instance, you don't have a D status in your voter ID, it does not automatically guarantee that you will be included in the NRC, right? And that's again something that is deeply, deeply worrying, right? So how denials spawn more denials, but inclusion does not allow for more inclusion. And this is true, like even for instance, those people who had doubtful statuses and who've had those statuses cleared, right? It takes a long time for this to disappear from, the record that remains with the Election Commission. That's again a allied thing to keep in mind. Okay, I've touched on various things. I want to now just wrap up, and I want to tie some of the threads of what I was saying and then open the floor for questions. So through the talk, what I was trying to capture was that there may be variegated standards of authentication. Authentication may come in different forms, and it may have different meanings, different names, and it may have different functionalities as well. But there are ways in which it enables sending people into exile. It enables all kinds of erasures of self and person, right? And I also wanted to bring out through this masterclass how all technologies have a claim to the universal, right? Even while they're rooted in surveillance. So the various pioneers of technologies will all say that it is a cutting edge and that it is a great improvement to what came before. But they will also talk about how it is scientifically reliable and scientifically universalizable. However, almost all of them are also rooted in surveillance agendas or surveillance projects that are aimed at marginal groups, right? And not always are these agendas, in the sense that technologies that are touted to be universal will have intended, unintended consequences, and there are ways in which they will retain their biases. That's again something to keep in mind. Authentication as having a cascading effect, but also as a spawning techno-utopias of purification and purity, right? That's again something that I wanted to illustrate, especially through the cases of both the electoral roll purification and the case of the NRC, right? And this is something to watch out for, because you are always going to have parallel schemes. You're always going to have not just doppelgangers, but other kinds of ambitious schemes, which all amplify the consequences of say the original techno utopia, right? So that's again something to keep in mind. And the last thing that I want to mention is also that the metrics and the standards of what identification and what unique identity are going to be different for different groups, and marginalized groups will experience each innovation with intensified stakes and experience each of them distinctly. I wanted to conclude by showing you a certain image from my fieldwork. It is very deliberately blurred to keep it as anonymous as possible. So in Govindpuri slum cluster, which is where I did my fieldwork and which I write about in my book as well, the residents of Delhi, the slum residents of Delhi, were issued something called the VP Singh card, right? And the VP Singh card was supposed to be a card that was issued once and only once. So its claimed uniqueness was not in terms of its fingerprinting or in terms of necessarily a photograph, though of course there was a photograph in the ID card. But its claimed uniqueness was that it had been issued once and only once, right? And never after that, right? And so so if you were a slum resident of Delhi during 1990, then the chances that you have a VP Singh card are very high, right? Now, people were supposed to hold on to this ID as carefully as possible, right? And not lose it. Of course, there were many things that happened. People did lose them. There were fires that also occurred in slums. And so when one such fire happened, there was a resident who waited for the embers to settle down, and then he retrieved the burnt fragment of the card, right? And he saw that only part of it was there, but he decided to laminate it just to sort of illustrate and demonstrate that this is what has happened to the card, but I still am a holder of the VP Singh card. So this is what happens when you insist on possessing unique identities, right? So let me stop with that. Yeah.
Hey,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry it took more time than what I should have. Yeah.
I think this is fascinating, and I'll just drop a remark in the Zoom chat, and I'll kind of talk a bit about why I find this fascinating. Because in your concluding remarks, you made you included this idea that all technologies, new and emergent, try and upsell the uniqueness, the scientific, rooted in the scientific approach. And yet, this claim to be specific, original, or unique, scientific, is something that we have been seeing for ages and years now. And this, I got reminded of this concept in a recent book on the Election Commission, which mentions very emphatically that the act of voting is not the only important part. What happens in a democracy is the process that leads all the way up to the voting, that gets a person to the polling booth. And a lot of that is linked to electoral rolls and one's presence on the electoral rolls. And going walking back, just like you did, it also means that one has to present not only an identity proof, but proof of residence. And a lot of our approaches towards that, by building on newfangled, unique technology, tends to limit access to democracy processes for quite a significant number of people. We, Uncharitably enough, I think we often read opinion pieces which say, oh, in a country of so many people of this percentage, this happens, it's a rounding of error. It might be a rounding of error, but not to the person who's facing the other end, sitting at the other end of that. So I think it's important for us to realize while we talk about election tech, the chilling part that you brought about is that identity has always been rooted in surveillance, and identity has been become such dominating part of our lives that the lack thereof tends to erase one from all sorts of access to government processes. It has been a fascinating walkthrough, all the stuff. And one of the things we tried to do as part of this project was to not just limit ourselves to looking at what is happening now, but try and examine what has happened, because a lot of these problems are echoes from the past. People before us have tried to solve this problem in a unique way, created more problems, more societal issues. But just sitting in the now and here and thinking that, oh, this is a novel problem for which I have a silver bullet that I'll unleash upon the entire population, is, I think, not just unfair, it's unjust and probably immoral as well. So with that, I'm going to stop, and I'm going to see if others on the chat are keen to make some remarks. I know we have a few folks who have been grappling with similar problems. I don't want to call them out to put on the spot, but if you do want, the mic is all yours. Let's have a bit of conversations. Rahul B, you raise your hand. Go ahead, unmute yourself and have a go.
Thank you, Sankarshan. Thanks a lot for the talk, Tarangini. It was really, really fascinating. Tarangini, I had a few questions for you, but I think one that really sticks out for me is, you know, you talked about NRC, and you talked about voter roll purification. I guess the 3 million people who went missing. And, you know, given recent history, you know, especially given the reaction to claims or to the evidence that, you know, people have gone missing and that this tech is being used in ways that, you know, is slightly undesirable, very, very undesirable by that, you know, for that matter. Given this recent history, do you have concerns and suspicions about where authentication tech like this might be used for purification and purity in the foreseeable future?
Okay. That's a good question. I would actually imagine that the Election Commission might bring it up through other routes and through other paths. That's one thing that I totally anticipate. In terms of like voter roll, I mean, the purification aspect of it, it's also possible that, I mean, to say right now, it's not really something that I can think about. But, you know, the very process of rolling out a one nation, one ration card scheme itself for me is a little bit worrying in that sense. And it has semblances of purification in that sense, right? Because you want to also ensure that a person has one ration card that he can carry everywhere. Now, while this does not have the same kind of manifestations of purification, there's a certain danger in going ahead with the One Nation, One Ration Card scheme as well, because, you know, the whole point of something like this is, of course, to enable someone to receive rations, right, on the move. But what might end up happening is you know, oftentimes, if you to look at, for instance, migrant workers, they want to leave their ration cards back home, right, when they travel, so that their family can access rations, right? And a process of cleansing such that, you know, a person should be able to access rations only in one place and not be able to access it in other places, it has a certain dangerous implications, right? So yeah, I would say that ration cards is one site perhaps that I would see this manifesting. Yeah.
Thank you.
I think one of the things that emerges from technology being unleashed and made available is that it generally, as a whole, they're never rolled back. They tend to persist. They tend to also find their way across various data stores, data collection regimes, and data processing regimes. And the problem these three items create is that it creates a level of correlation that is otherwise not found or otherwise not easily done. And that probably is one of the worries that we should try and start becoming more aware about, that data is quite easily correlated. And this idea that everything should be linked to one unique identifier, and then that gets to be used as the source of truth, also means that the costs associated with finding or figuring out grievances and getting redressal for them increases proportionately. Because if you had different data stores, like the likelihood of the impact on your life and livelihood would be less. But now if you have one central, one number to bind them all, and that's the one that is causing all the issues for you, then you are going to be in harm's way, in right quid, and it's going to get right ugly in no time. So yeah, that's one of the things that came to my mind, is that correlation is a topic that we should at some point in time start talking about and also discussing. We usually imply it, but that's there.
Yeah, the example of that I was giving, and that journalists and academics galore have been talking about, of SRDHs, especially, is, I think, extremely dangerous in that regard, Sankarshan, what you were mentioning. Yeah, I mean, but it's not just that, right? It's not just like any one type of SRDH also, right? Like this, like there's the Bhamasha database of Rajasthan. There's the Andhra Pradesh government has its own certain types of databases. But also, you know, the related to what you were saying about data correlation and collection is also the allied point of like how you're going to allow for people to see all of this, right? Whether you're going to allow people to see this, or whether you want to like make certain certain aspects visible and hide other aspects, all of that is problematic. And this is where I think a friend is very right in pointing out, like I was having this conversation with a friend. I think the problem is not just about compromised databases. It's not just, we shouldn't just be talking about data breaches. We should be talking about the very design of databases, right? Such that they're often set up to be correlated in all these ways, and you know, even though UIDA might cry foul about it, I would say that it is something that they are okay with, right? And it's not just the UIDA, but several other such data collecting agencies, that they are okay with it. They have intended it in at some level or the other, right? When I was also talking about the party in power and the party that plans to be in power, right, and the line being swim, that's exactly what I meant, right? SRDHs are also set up in such a way that by design they are to be leaky, right? So that's something. And I just also realized that, you know, Rahul, I would say that one other place that I anticipate this attempt at some kind of cleansing, purification to happen is also pension fraud, in terms of like cracking down on pension fraud. And yeah, it's the nitty-gritties of it I would have to think about, but yeah.
This brings me to another question. Sorry, I there may be others with lots of questions, but I've got a few of my own. Given the timing of SRDHs, I think when Aadhaar began, or rather when it was rolled out, UID was rolled out the first time, and you had whatever information was available, general as it was at that point back in 2009, you were told this is for welfare and this is for corruption. And there was that extremely large number and that extremely simple message that they were spreading everywhere. At the same time, I think a year later or so, we, you know, if you sort of do a search, you find mails that show that they were working on SRDHs at the same time. And I'm not sure if we were aware at that moment with, you know, what SRDHs were, how they were happening and what exactly they meant. So when you look back at that, I mean, you know, you mentioned in your presentation that these technologies, they eventually become broader and they become, you know, they encapsulate a lot more. They become something else. Does that apply to Aadhaar, or do you think like from the get-go, it had a dual purpose? It was many things to many different sets of people.
Yeah, that's a good question. It's, in fact, I think Usha Ramanathan's whole corpus of work has been about this, right? And her answer would be in the affirmative, that it was definitely intended like that, right? And there's so many examples to give, Rahul, in this regard. But one thing, maybe we can narrow it down to one interesting conversation, which is that, like, if you were to look at the mandate of Aadhaar, like, what exactly is it? Like, you want it at the same time to be a very reliable form of identification and authentication, which is cloud-based and all of that, right? And which is something that that can be universally applied in some senses. But then when you do that, then the UID is keenly aware, Neelakani was keenly aware, that he's setting himself up for all kinds of accusations about data breach, right? But what's the other way in which you can claim it? That Aadhaar is like any other kind of ID, right? I mean, so you can say that, but that's again a claim that they cannot make, right? So it's in a way they're caught between these conflicting desires, right? On the one hand, to be able to say that, look, why are we being singled out for all these accusations where the certain technologies of like crosswalking existed even before? And on the other hand, saying that this is in every way unique, right? So there's that to keep in mind.
I was just listening to you. Yeah, sorry, okay.
I thought you had something else to add. So that's one thing. What else to keep in mind? Yeah, so it's also very convenient, right? So oftentimes all you need is, like, for instance, say the some order to emerge, right? And that order can be very vague, right? The order can be from the Supreme Court. And it says that, look, mobile phone verification is to be carried out, right? Now, the Supreme Court is not saying that mobile phone, verification of who's applying should be carried out through Aadhaar. But that's very extremely easy to carry out on the ground, right? And that is exactly what has happened. And again, there are multiple instances of this happening. Right? So, yeah. Zainab is also, should we like maybe take another question and Rahul?
Yeah, there is
Rahul,
I'm going to swing back to you. There's one interesting remark from YouTube that I'm going to read out, and then this question that Zainab has posted. So the remark is that if it's in the government's interest to have maximum surveillance, how can one convince them to stop collecting? Would we need the courts to allow a provision to refuse to provide one's anthropometry? I think that kind of circles back to the last point you just made, that the courts can intervene and then limit the scope and the purpose and the specificity to be able to do. But nonetheless, I'd like to sort of have a quick remark from you if you would want that.
Can you just repeat it? Maximum surveillance?
The government's interest to have maximum surveillance, how can one convince them to stop collecting?
So that's the other interesting part, right? I mean, so the UIDI, if you were to look at it and the various kinds of proof of concept documents and the various kinds of documents that they generated early on and later on also, they try to actually draw a wedge, right, as much as possible. And they talk about how it is purely about a welfare function, right? That is tied to certain welfare functions, right? And later on, the Aadhaar Act also tries to reinforce these impressions that it is It's entirely for welfare purposes. But what food activists, RTI activists, several others have all tried to explain is that, you know, it's for one, you cannot talk about privacy as something that is only an elite concern, that it is very much tied to the methods through which you are able to access these benefits, right? And it's also tied to the process of accessing these benefits, right? So, so how is it that the Aadhaar is enabling surveillance through what are seen to be standard welfare provisioning services, right? That's a conversation that we should be having, really.
Right. Thank you. How about this one, which came up, that how adequate or not are the draft provisions in the Data Protection Bill in providing a framework for redressal of grievances towards the central systems of data collection?
I have to say that I have to go back and look at the Data Protection Bill. I haven't looked at it in recent times. I saw it a while back. But I can say this, from what I remember, is that the Data Protection Bill, which takes off from, if I'm not mistaken, the Sri Krishna Commission report, right? This particular bill also has, you know, the way in which it frames certain important, what it sees to be important concerns, what it sees to be priorities, right? Is that it's constantly also, like, for instance, trying to balance secure data, right, with what is called a legitimate state interest, right? And for me, that's a very dangerous slope to be treading on, right? And if you're constantly going to be talking about legitimate state interest and then weighing the potential kinds of the potential kinds of necessity, right, for carrying out data gathering, right? You're saying that data is something that is absolutely necessary to gather, indispensable to gather for protecting certain state interests. Now, by framing it in that way, you are automatically sort of making this a conversation not about what data means for people personally, not about what data means people for people who are submitting it in myriad ways, right? But you're making it a conversation about a state interest, right? So that's something that I can say. And of course, the language itself is also something I would assume to be problematic, right? When you're talking about data fiduciaries, right? And data sovereignty, that again becomes problematic, because again, what are you valuing, right? What public goods are you valuing? What kinds of personhoods are you not valuing, right? Those are, again, conversations to be had. Thanks, Zainab. I'll definitely copy this.
Yeah, that actually is, for others who are who have the link, it's a great report to go through about the PDP bill, and there's a associated work on the privacy topic at HasGig as well that's ongoing. So one of the things that we have had conversations previously is that these challenges are not unique or new to India, in the sense like these are challenges that are being faced, as you point out, by in other countries. This is also a set of challenges that have been a key theme or issue around voting process changes and improvements in Pakistan. And Dr. Taha Ali has been writing about it for a while and investigating on this topic. And I wondered if you wanted to make some remarks on the conversation we are having today, as well as how this vexed topic of identity and identification documents also relates to the process of democratic changes around voting and voting processes.
Oh, hello. Good to hear you. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Audience. Right. I don't have any direct comments on this. So this has been a fascinating and very new kind of talk for me. And it's very, very interesting. I just had a very, I just remembered something from listening to this conversation about, so what is happening is that we in the developing world, we're actually trying to move towards authentication frameworks and automated tools. And in the West has already gone through this. And there was just this slightly humorous observation I remembered, you might find it interesting, which was that essentially what happens out there, if you lose, if some, so banks maintain records of how to identify you and how to authenticate you. But what happens quite a bit of times is that when the banks lose that information, they pin that on the customer. They sort of make, they say that your identity has been stolen. Even though it's not the customer's fault at all, what's really happened is that the bank has basically compromised or lost the ability to authenticate him. So this is a, so it's just something I thought you might find interesting. Regarding elections, obviously, Sankarshan was right that the electoral rolls have a lot of problems in many countries. I think that's the biggest problem, that that's why we had the coup in Burma recently. And this is one thing that I'm writing about nowadays, which is the fact that even if you bring in very high-flying voting technology, unless you clarify these issues on the side, like issues like authentication and marginalization and all, and voter coercion, you don't really get the full benefit of trustworthy technologies or trustworthy elections. So that's just my two cents, and I hope it's entertaining and useful.
No, thanks a lot. Yeah. No, what you're saying also about the state banks being able to palm off the problem, or to be able to be in denial that there has been some liability on their parts, is also actually a little too resonant for me at this point in time, because I just encountered this happening to somebody very recently. And, you know, what's interesting also is that, you know, there are rules which say that you should be able to complain within the next 3 days, right, by simply going to the bank and reporting it. But I accompanied the person whom this happened to, and we were sort of told that, you know, without an FIR, this cannot get done. This identity theft cannot be reported. While you know, there's actually no requirement like that, and we were able to manage. We were able to do it over the phone, not in person. So it's yeah. Anyway. But thank you also for telling me the other part about electoral rolls in Pakistan and Burma.
Rahul, I know you said that you had a few more questions. Do you want to take a stab at them now?
No, I'll reach out to Tarangini separately for those. Thank okay. you. Sorry.
Yeah, I just could not resist getting that comment about how to stop the government from collecting data in, because it feels so natural. It felt so natural at that point in time, because the state, by its very definition, does collect data to be able to offer services and provide services. But more often than not, the state has become this massive data hub that seems to suck up everything about us. And more importantly, use our entire body surface as markers, biometric markers, and then sort of try and narrow box us into being able to be identified as unique. And that's why I find this entire masterclass and the conversation today is very very relevant to what we are trying to do in election tech, is because the process of elections is often understood with gaps in India. We tend to so here's the thing, like unlike other various commissions, the Election Commission does not draw its power actually from the parliament. It is enshrined in the constitution, which kind of makes it a very strange, a very unique and very cherished institution by itself, and it draws its governance processes in a very transparent manner. And even though I'm aware that the appointment of election commissioners and the chief election commissioner has not been smooth, and they've been fraught with a lot of controversies, especially during, I think it started off during MS Gill's time. But nonetheless, the Constituent Assembly debates and the Constitution mandated an election commission to exist. When India as a country decided on universal suffrage, it actually had the election commission and the then election commissioner making bold decisions that during those times would have actually been looked at with a lot of tension and nervousness. And yet here we are 70 plus years down from that moment in time, and we are still circling our wheels on the same thing. How to be able to determine whether a person is supposed to exist on the electoral rolls and thus be able to find themselves eligible to cast their ballots. And the only difference that I see that has been made is that we have now started talking about technologies that seemingly are expensive, fancy, newfangled, and also not proven in the scheme of things. So those are the things interesting. There's a question on YouTube that says that while savings in welfare pilferage are touted as benefit of the other system, how can we mandate authorities to quantify the opportunity cost to those no longer able to access what is legally due to them? I wonder if this is something that would be far more good in a specific Aadhaar-related conversation, but I wouldn't want to sort of box you in, Tarangani, if you want to have a remark and provide some...
So the opportunity cost has been very high with regard to?
How can we mandate authorities to quantify the opportunity cost to those no longer able to access what is legally due to them?
Right. It's a difficult one. But let me just first actually comment on what you had to say, Sankarshan, then I'll come to this particular question. So one of the things that I mean it's more like it's more like a unrealistic, idealized desire on my part right now to see a legislation for the repeal of Aadhaar. I mean, it would be really nice if that could happen, but of course I'm not going to hedge my bets on that one. What I would like to point out is what is I think has been a little disheartening is that of course there has been civil society agitations, if I could use that, or civil society dissent against Aadhaar, let's put it that way, right? And there's been a lot of litigation also in terms of resisting the various advances that Aadhaar has made, right? In terms of crosswalking, in terms of what it entails in privacy, in terms of what it means to be a fraud on what it has been called as. It's been called a fraud on the Constitution and by of course, one of the justices. But again, the petitions have enabled this kind of pronouncements to happen. But what we have not seen, and that especially, you know, if you to think of an anti-CEA movement style resistance, right, or style mobilization, we have not seen something like that happen. And it would have been really good to see something like that, right, manifest itself. Right, and especially in, if you to look at the history of South Africa, you've had very robust, though mostly historical, evidence of that kind of mobilization, counter mobilization against the ID system, and it would have been nice to see that. That's one thing I wanted to mention. The other thing I want to mention is, you know, as far as you know, quote unquote solutions go, quote and quote, you know, how to get governments to collect less data goes, right? I would also say that, I mean, I think the certain precedents have to be created, right? Precedents have to be created in different realms, I would say. So you would have to create precedents, for instance, in the realm of voting. Like, for instance, Shubhashish was talking about this in a previous masterclass. Like, why don't we look at the carrying out more reliable audits, for instance, of VVPAT chains, right? So that would be a good thing instead of like moving towards blockchain or something else. Let's do that, right? And in the realm of say food distribution, like you have something called point of sale machines, right? So instead of having those point of sale machines collect biometrics, let us instead simply have them like record the ration card details, right? The family's ration card details, and find a way of ensuring that those POS machines are answerable, or you know, they faithfully reflect the food that was being regularly drawn, right, by the families. Let's have a proper record of that. Let's have POS machines do that instead of biometric authentication, right? So I think that we need to have those kinds of like localized conversations across different realms. And I think that might create a certain precedent also to then take on Aadhaar, right? And so without having those kinds of like bold precedents, it's not going to be able for us to, you know, dismantle data collection, whether it is Aadhaar, whether it is something else, right? Whether it's Aarogya Setu or something else. That's one thing. As far as opportunity costs are concerned, I would say that, yeah, I mean, that's exactly what you are seeing, right? Like, for instance, like even Usha Ramanathan talks about, you know, the if you to look at the proof of concept kinds of documents that UIDA had, there very deliberately you had certain people who were not being selected in terms of testing out the efficacy of Aadhaar, right? The efficacy of biometric collection, right? People who had all kinds of quote unquote compromised fingerprints, like whether they were elderly, whether they were disabled in some form or the other, were not, for on the one hand, not being taken into account, but were not being taken on as far as the exercise of testing the Aadhaar and biometric source. But opportunity costs, you know, if you to look at especially, you know, how in various kinds of regions, right, whether you're talking about regions with tribal communities and whether you're talking about regions, case studies, for instance, where leprosy patients, for instance, have attempted to again try and access welfare goods and services. There again, the opportunity costs for them have been extremely high, right? So it's the story is one that kind of like has newer and newer ramifications and manifestations, right? So this was something that was talked about as far back as the late 19th century, where, for instance, Henry Foulds talks about it, right? And how the opportunity costs are going to be higher for certain people compared to others, right? I hope that answers your question, because he did talk about like people with tuberculosis. He talked about people with certain kinds of deformities as again being extremely at risk, right? Even as far back as the late 19th century when he was looking at universalizing it.
That remark and question came to us through YouTube. So we'll wait and see if there's further comments. These masterclasses are fun because the input just comes in from every possible channels. And I'm trying to get more clarification on a set of comments that are made in the Karana's Telegram channel. The idea was that I'm going to read it out a bit by sort of editing some of the things that are written. But anyway, it goes something like this. All the bombast and propaganda around, and the myths built around high-tech like Aadhaar that it is essentially fundamental rights destroying and humanity negating and basically garbage in application. These could be easily punctured once the word liability is attached to it. The basic principles of accountability and liability should be at the foundations of any and every tech that scales like this and has the potential for harm like this. So I think this is more a remark and an observation than a question, but I generally, yes, would agree with it. Your thoughts?
Yeah, no, I mean to say the scalability question is, very much like it's almost like a no-brainer, right? When if you're saying that you're scaling up authentication services, then you're also scaling up the possibilities of that just going very badly wrong, right? And that's exactly what I have been trying to also, and not just me, I mean a bunch of others, right, both in the activist and academic circles have also been trying to demonstrate. Yeah, I agree with the spirit of what is being said.
Yeah, I can sense the anger coming out of it, and I think it's righteous. I can deal with that. But it is indeed true. I think one of the things that again, in technology discourse and critique in India, we often do not touch upon very strongly is the idea of responsible tech, and especially tech that is deployed on nation scale. And it's not just in India, right? And Nanjala's conversations around the elections in Kenya, I watched that talk twice now and just sat back and thought, like, who in the right mind would think that is a brilliant way of doing things? And yet here we are. It actually has been provided to a nation, and there are other nations who are now repeating that playbook. And so it goes. Tech, once unleashed in a country, tends to find its supporters every single place across the world. So I wanted to say that we were at the cusp of sort of wrapping this one up. So I'm going to go around the room and check if there are remarks or questions from any of those who have given their time on this Saturday to participate and join us. Or even you, Tarangini, if you want to do closing remarks a bit. And then after that, we'll just sort of bring it home and close it up.
Yeah, no, I was just thinking about the scalability question, and I was just also thinking that, you know, along with the things that are being scaled up are also, you know, the scaling up of like database providers, right, and authentication providers and a whole bunch of other entities, right? And I'm also wondering if, you know, more and more, you know, there was already a certain tenuousness in terms of being able to separate who was engineering the UIDAI database, right? Who was behind the architecture, who was setting up the architecture, the technological architecture of the UIDAI database, and who are the people who are also enjoying office in the UIDAI, who are the people who are providing certain kinds of biometric services, right? Linked to all of this. That line was already being very blurred, right? And you know, with the various other stories that I also tried to recount, right? The SRDHS and the very many other entities that have emerged, right? That in terms of technocratic ambition, in terms of like technocratic career trajectories, software engineers, and a whole industrial complex that has emerged, I think we're not going to be able to tell apart these things, right? If we continue with certain extremely mulish tendencies that authentication is absolutely indispensable for any kind of reliable welfare ecosystem, right? And we're seeing that also to be importing certain lessons, right? This whole Aadhaar ecosystem and the people who seem to be like incestually tied up, right, within the Aadhaar ecosystem. I'm pretty sure that this has lessons to impart for us also in other regards, right? In terms of like, for instance, again, what is happening on the Aarogya Setu front, right? I would say that, you know, Byzantine schemes and the machinations that go into setting up those Byzantine schemes are not only going to be replicable, but they're also going to leave a trail of devastation, which is going to be very much socioeconomic, cultural, and not just technological. I think we can leave it there. I mean, that would be my concluding comment.
Indeed. And to that, I would add that the lay citizen being not able to access information, knowledge to identify these challenges that lie in front of them, these problems that are emerging out of everything. For instance, you mentioned Aarogya Setu. The entire vaccination effort suddenly spawned out a new health ID for all of us. Yeah, and so there is always this new national level ID that jumps out of the woodwork for many a thing. And it's a wonder that that there are so many unique national level IDs floating around. But true.
Yeah, I just wanted to add quickly that, by the way, I mean, the ways in which I think we are seeing immunity passports and Aarogya Setu and all kinds of you know, exposure notifications, all of these also as feeding into each other as we speak, right? Uh, so, So yeah, I just wanted to drop that in as well.
Yeah, true. All right. So first up, I'd like to thank you, Tarangani, for making time today to have this conversation. We started off with a very simple topic of identity as it stands. And then we walked all the way up to the fact that identity as it stands has impact that we don't often quantify and measure or realize. And more importantly, we don't realize that there are policies and proposals based around identity that could easily deny us services from the government that are due to us, or more importantly, make us stateless as well in certain cases. So the potential for harms are plenty. And the Election Tech project is probably just one small aspect of it, a place where we are trying to demonstrate that technology is to be used for good, but technology should not be left alone and cannot be not criticized. It has to be examined. It has to be examined through a set of scientific frameworks, and to be able to arrive at a situation where it is easily understood by non-practitioners or lay audience, so that the next iteration of technology that emerges for any other part of our life, it can be a natural reflexive action for any individual in the country, any citizen, to be able to assess and evaluate and say, no, I do not want this because this seems to be going against what are my rights. And I think as part of the project at Karana, we aspire to ensure that we communicate this effectively, simply, and to be able to gather more experts like yourself as we try and build up some momentum in exploring the critique of technology. Before we close this one up, just a few things that are coming up. One of the things that is going to happen in the coming month, it's already the last day of July, so let's say in the month of August, is that we are going to synthesize all that we have heard and learned and discussed as part of this masterclasses to be into an interim report that we'll publish on the website. The idea is to use that report to get some feedback and some initial recommendations brought up. And then from there on, we'll go towards a final report that we can circulate among, perhaps also among those who are creating all these policies. And hopefully we can make some change, because there's worth taking that attempt and making that attempt to make those changes. And we'll see how that goes. So thank you again. And with that, we'll close this webinar up.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. This has been really exciting for me as well.
And if you, all of you who are on the webinar today, and if you want to continue this conversation, Karana has the Telegram group, which is on days very chatty, but most of the days it's not. So you could try and join that. That link is there on the Election Tech project page as well on hasgeek.com. Thank you so much.
Thanks.